Welcome back to another episode of Behind the Scenes with Beyut and Dubizel, where we introduce you to the minds that create all the magic at UAE's first homegrown unicorn. Today, I'm super excited to talk to Head of Engineering at Dubizel, Harris Ali Khan, who is almost like the Dubizel Encyclopedia. He was one of the first few people to join Dubizel and is now at integral part of the Stronger Together Beyut Dubizel family. Hi, Harris.
Hello, Charles.
How are you doing?
I'm very good. Thank you.
It's nice to have you on the show. And thank you for taking the time out. This is something that I tell every esteemed guest of ours.
Oh.
Taking the time out. And again, thank you for that.
Thank you for inviting me.
So there's this small bit that I did before you came,
yeah,
where I was giving sort of like your introduction,
mm-hmm,
and I introduced you as the encyclopedia of Dubizel. Do you think that's a fitting name, and can you sort of give us how did your journey begin with Dubizel?
So I joined Dubizel in 2009 as a junior developer. I had gone to UK for studies, worked there for a bit, came back, applied, got called for an interview, came into a villa where there was a dog roaming around. It was a very cool office.
Villa.
And this, we were in Jumeirah back then, and I think I was the 13th employee and 5th developer. I joined as a junior developer and sort of worked my way from there. But the journey has been amazing. I've had incredible mentors, very smart people got to work with. Mm-hmm. And always felt that I grew from every stage to the other. And this is one of the questions that normally people ask me is like, why did you end up staying for 11 years almost? Actually, wow. I'll complete 12 years towards the end of the year. And why for a tech person, especially where the normally people jump from one company to the other, especially in tech, I ended up staying because I think my growth never stopped. And also the people that I ended up working were amazing. And then I felt always, and I still feel, this is almost my company. Mm-hmm. So the ownership comes very differently to a lot of people, I think. And I think similarly, this company was always an exception where we had a lot of people that ended up staying for longer periods of time, especially in Dubai, which is a transient place anyhow. Like, people normally come and go relatively fast, but most people ended up staying over here.
That's amazing. 12 mm-hmm. years. Well, almost 12 years.
Yeah.
Getting there. That's, yeah. That's big. So let's talk about the something that happened in between,
mm-hmm,
where of course we had the merger,
yep,
of, you know, two big ones.
Mm-hmm.
How was that, as you know, being part of the pioneering, yeah, team from the beginning? Mm-hmm. How was the whole process? How was your feeling towards it? And
To be honest, we were very surprised. We did not anticipate this or expect this. During that period, we were in lockdown. So we found out then. I remember my manager basically called in a meeting, invited us, gave us the news. We had obviously 100 questions to ask. I think it's the game is for us to lose now.
That's the positive attitude going in, right?
Thank you.
Every single day. That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Harris, of course, you're the head of engineering at Dubizel.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always been curious about this. What is it that the engineering team does? And are there different sections within the engineering team?
One of the questions that gets often asked is, the website's running. What do you guys do? We have multiple platforms at Dubizel. So we have 4, which is Android, iOS, and then you obviously have the browsers on a mobile device and desktop. So we support those. The teams, the way that we have done that is we have structured our teams according to the business.
Mm-hmm.
So property, motors, these are significant businesses for us. So our teams also, structure reflects that. So you have a team focusing just on motors, on property. Then we have these sort of central services which work horizontally or across the entire platform. So we have teams focusing on those, like chat, for example, would be a feature that multiple categories use. So something like that. And that's how the structure is most of the time. Sometimes we do create project-based teams or feature-based teams, where, for example, search or chat might have a team on its own. but most of the times, and we have had evolution throughout. I think also the problems that you're trying to solve in that quarter or in that year, you sometimes change the structure slightly to reflect that. But I think in most of the times, and what we have been very successful with is vertical teams, which is basically as per the business, because the rest of the teams reflect that. So you have sales, you have operations, you have product, you have even marketing that are only focusing on the property. So everyone's thinking along the same lines, and we want the engineering to also do that. So they're just thinking property. So a feature or a release, sometimes these changes might not be user facing.
How does just pivoting or just continuing the topic on feature releases that we have?
Yes.
I know that we find or we do a lot of innovative solutions for our partners' problems. Is there any particular challenge that we are working on right now?
Yes. I think one of our main mottos is to basically bring convenience to our buyers and sellers. So one of the things that we are getting into is deliveries. We're trying to see what's Dubizzle 2.0 and how can we take this normal classifieds experience and go a bit further, try to relieve basically some of the pain points that the journey basically of an item being sold by a seller all the way till it gets handed to the buyer. How can we resolve those pain points? And delivery is one of the biggest. And the good thing over here, at least in UAE, is this entire infrastructure of deliveries is already set up. But there are a lot of other challenges that we face because this is one of the first few times that you will start transferring secondhand items. So you have very different challenges to trading a brand new item. So we are looking into that, we are doing that. The couple of other things that we are doing is also we're looking at some of the data that we have. How can we educate the user more for them to make better decisions? So for example, showing trends, what's good to buy, what's the depreciation of an item, for example, for car. If we can show that information to a dealer, then the inventory could be something that they can buy accordingly. Things like those we are also looking at. So we're trying to see where can we resolve some of these pain points. And obviously we're trying to grow the business as well.
All right. And just going a bit backward again,
yeah.
You said that during the releases, we had to have at least like three people come in and do it like early morning. From then, how big has the team grown? And if you're looking for a person to join your team, is there any specific quality or aspect that you look at?
Good question. One of the things that we're doing is obviously we're growing the team right now. We've already hired quite a few people recently and we'll continuously do so. So if you are a developer looking for a new opportunity, please find us on LinkedIn or contact me somehow. We'll try to at least get you an interview if you fit the bill. The things that we look for, we have this motto where like developers are called always nerdy, monkeys on keyboard. These are some of the phrases that have been used to define them. So we sort of negate that. We want really business thinkers. So our developers are actually quite aware of what they're working on and why they're working on it. So they would question the PMs, for example, if they have a request that they have that we want to build on the platform. They will question why we are doing it. What will it change? What will it impact? The reason for this is then they can actually suggest sometimes, most of the times, better ideas. So because the developers actually know the code base. For example, if you're trying to move a number from A to B, there might be an easier solution to move that number. So they have that context. So the teams actually work together and ideate to try to grow the business across.
Something that I probably did not expect, especially the monkey part of it. But you know, talking about the technologies that our developers work on, is there any particular technology that we bank on and probably we have been dependent on like for a few years?
I think the biggest change that has happened in software development in the past quite a few years now is cloud computing, I think. I think that has changed the way that I spoke about releases. I think that enabled us to release at a click of a button. There are things like CI/CD, which is basically continuous integration and continuous deployment or delivery, where you just click a button, they are the change that you're trying to make, you'll run all your automation suite, basically automated tests that sort of test whether your website is functioning properly. And then once those pass, the change goes into production automatically. Before, for example, say we had during Eid or any event where you have a lot of users coming to your platform. It was very difficult. We had to prepare for that event so that we have more servers that we add. We use something called load balancers to balance the load. So if traffic is coming to your platform, and if you have multiple servers that you want to distribute your load, you use something like load balancer. That's the simplistic form, but there's no now sophisticated versions of it. But now at a click of a button, actually not even a button, it's auto scaled now. So you have a min and a max number, and your website will have n numbers of servers accordingly. And as soon as the traffic increases, it will add more servers to it. When it reduces in the night, it will remove some servers for it to be cost efficient as well. So things like these did not really exist, and now it's really simple to create a platform.
Everything just happens.
Yeah.
Wow.
Magic.
You know, talking about cloud computing, that's I wouldn't say one of the very recent technology, but that is something that's seen a big boom over the years. Mm-hmm. Is there any other technology that you're particularly in awe of?
With data, to be honest, we can do a lot. This is where you see AI and ML. These are the buzzwords that most people use, but I think the applications of these two technologies are amazing. And this is where the world is gravitating towards, because now you can make better decisions. That's the ultimate thing. Mm-hmm. For us also, we're trying to leverage where we can. For example, you're trying to list an item. How can you help you select a category? Very simple. Or you're trying to list an item for a price, and we can educate you that actually this is below the market price. You can probably get a little bit more, and vice versa. So things like those, I think, are very interesting for us, which we're trying to get into. We already have. We are using it internally for a few things. We want to expose it to the users to make them make better decisions. I think that for me, it's because the applications of this technology is everywhere. Like every single decision that's made by any product can be powered by this technology.
One of the examples that we can see, you know, where data gathering and the application has worked very well is Google Maps. Mm.
Absolutely. I think it's one of my favorite products.
Yeah.
If you think about before Google Maps, how would you get to a place? Like it was difficult. And now we take it for granted, but it has solved so many of the problems. It has actually created companies around it. Like if you think about Uber, Kareem, mm-hmm. they won't exist without Google Maps.
I think even family businesses that, you know, you wouldn't usually find.
Yeah.
If you look for restaurants nearby, you know, petrol stations and so on.
Absolutely.
You get them on Google Maps.
And the whole aspect of being able to see live traffic, for example, when I leave home, mm-hmm. I have four different routes that I can get to work. So what I do is every day I check where there's an accident or traffic. I would avoid that and take a different route. Yeah. So it has allowed me to save time every single day. I remember I went on a northern trip in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. The driver did not know much. I was going for the first time. We used Google Maps and it actually worked all the way through.
Talking to you about which is technology and engineering, and you know, we can go on and on, even though you would probably at some point stop. But my question is more on how do you get interested in engineering? Was there a particular trigger? Was it more of a transition? What was it?
I think since my dad was a big influence on me, I think he's an engineer by heart, so he would do all his DIY stuff himself. And I think through that I got into things. When you get into things, you really want to know how it works.
Right.
And when you want to try to answer that, you get into the mechanics of it, whether it's physical or mechanical, you really want to get into it. So I think that's where my interest developed. And then in computers, when the computers came, I got super interested mostly for games initially. So I used to be an avid gamer. But then I used to build desktops, change components, really started liking it. Then I think grade 7 or 6, I think we started programming for the first time. I think the language was GW Basic. So we did that and then liked it a little, didn't understand it fully. But then when I took a couple of courses in my O-levels, that's when I started getting interested into the field. Then I had decided, I was confused actually between two fields, aeronautical engineering and computer science. Mm-hmm. Ended up opting computer science. More widely used, I felt at that time, aeronautical would be more constrained just towards aerospace. So I picked that. I was confused though whether I want to do hardware or software in the end. I think second year in my uni, I realized that I want to get into software because programming made sense. I really liked it. And been doing that since. Although for the past few years, I've not really gotten a full-on chance to actually code something. I do try to do here and there bug fixes or code review, but that's I think where my interest for engineering and computer science came from.
Just going back one step, we know that you know you haven't left that aeronautical DNA in the past. We know that you're a petrol head at heart, on the fly. And this is sort of like a natural question, you know. Which cars have you driven? What's your daily driver right now?
I loved cars since the beginning. My dad was a used car salesman. So that's where the interest came from. He used to get, every now and then he would get a new car. I would take it out from the parking lot. But that's where the interest came from. I got my license in UK, came back over here. My first car was Camry. Loved that car, used it for a year and a half, gave it to my brother, he destroyed it completely.
Your brother destroyed a Camry?
It was used for quite a few years. But currently I drive a Merc.
Okay.
I recently got it imported from Japan because they're really expensive over here. So I got a really good deal.
Oh, so Mercs are expensive here but not in Japan?
For some reason, it's weird. We got it from an auction.
All right.
But in AMG versions, it's really fast, really good fun to drive.
Naturally, the next question that flows right in is, which is your dream car? Do you have one? Are there many? Go into as much as detail as you want.
Actually, one of my dream cars was Nissan Patrol. Back in the day, like I could not really think that I would afford one.
Okay.
And I ended up buying one, so which was good. Still have it. Merc was another. I was able to sort of accomplish my goal. So that way I've been, alhamdulillah, very lucky. But next car, S-Class has always impressed me.
550? Coupe?
550 or 63 AMG, obviously you'll go with the best. But no, to be honest, one of my favorite cars to drive is Golf GTI. Mm-hmm. It's like a go-kart on road. Incredibly responsive, amazing drive.
I think you were driving it at one point.
Yeah, right? Yeah. It was my brother's car.
Did you take it from him?
We still have it actually.
You took it from him because he broke the Camry?
No, so he went to Canada, so he left it and we still have it. We have not sold it yet. He'll come back and he'll sell it. So we still drive it every now and then. Amazing car.
Unfortunately, we'll have to stop talking about cars and let's concentrate a bit on you. So just a few more questions to sort of, you know, get to know you a bit better.
Yes, sir.
If there's anywhere in this world that you would live, apart from your hometown and apart from Dubai, where would it be and why?
I like city because I've lived in cities most of my life, but countryside actually would be nice as long as I have internet connection and Wi-Fi. I think that's really important. I don't think I can do the...
We can't take the laptop away from you.
Yeah, that's too difficult. But I would love to at least escape for a bit. I'm sure I'll get bored eventually. Would want the hustle bustle of a city, but that idea is super interesting for me.
So you won't give us a straight answer. Okay. Let's say that you won a very expensive car.
No.
Okay, I'm gonna go like a Bugatti Chiron, 15 mil, 16 mil dirhams, right? Would you drive it every day?
Definitely sell it. Shall I do something useful for my money? I would not. Yeah, the thing is, although I love cars, but cars are not an asset. They depreciate really badly, and I had my experience when I bought one of the cars. So I don't want to spend a lot of money on cars.
So you sort of put yourself into this question. Where would you invest that money?
I think property could be one option if you wanted to buy. I think saving up for that so that you can eventually buy a house. That and but there are so many other avenues now. There are startups that are coming up. You can invest in those. Obviously, there's whole thing on crypto that you can get into as well. Quite a few and stocks if you are interested in. So there are a few avenues where you can make some money.
Literally gone through assets and you've gone to equity. Nice.
Although I've not done it yet, but I'm super interested and curious to do it.
Okay. And this is the final question. Yeah. You can be relieved now.
Okay.
What is the wildest dream that you've wanted to do in this world? Let's say that you've got the resources for it. Money, people, you've got everything in order to accomplish it. What would that be?
I want to fly a plane, learn how to fly an aeroplane and a fighter jet probably. That would be amazing if I could. So that's one thing. I wanted to get into aeronautical engineering, and because it was my interest in aerospace. Actually, at one point I wanted to be an Air Force pilot. So that's where the entire thing came from. But yeah, I would love to fly a plane.
Thank you very much for the time.
Thank you.
How was it being with us on the show?
It was very good. A little nervous, but I think it was a normal conversation that we normally have at a water cooler.
All right. Thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you so much.
Until
for
next
inviting
time.
Me. Thank you. Bye.
We've come to the end of another episode, and we hope that it gave you a better idea about our engineering team at Dubizzle. If you have what it takes to join our talented team, don't hesitate to get in touch. I'll be back with more faces from behind the scenes at Bayut and Dubizzle. Stay tuned and don't forget to share your thoughts in the comments below.